Welcome back, everybody. This panel is titled Enter and Revive, Conditions for Accessibility and Reuse. It's going to be our last panel. This is about how do you make archives alive or keep them alive. I mean, reissued records or MP3s that we've discussed before are alive or not in private archives. So owners bear no responsibility if anybody has access to that. Whereas institutions do feel or should feel or should see the need to make their archives available to the public to reuse and revive it. This is what we would like to discuss with you now. And I would briefly introduce my participants to this panel, and they would then show your presentation, and afterwards we start the discussion. So you get to know everybody through their presentation. Just a brief introduction. I start at the end there. This is Cornelia Solfrank. Cornelia is net art and cyberfeminism pioneer, artist and researcher, and Cornelia has worked a lot on the field of commons as a new form of political self-organization and authorship and intellectual property. So that's what we would like to discuss with you, or hope input from you. Welcome. And next to Cornelia is Maricela Uma. Maricela is one of the leading experts in intellectual property in Kenya and all of Africa, and until 2015 was executive director of the Kenya Copyright Board, which you helped establish. Welcome. Maricela works on laws for protection of traditional knowledge, traditional cultural expressions, intangible cultural heritage. Next to Maricela is Diane, Trum. Okay, Diane Trum, welcome. Diane is Professor Emerita at Rhodes University in South Africa and former director of the International Library of African Music, which is the oldest and largest repository of African music field recordings in the world. Welcome. In Africa, okay. And then in Africa, okay. Welcome. And next to me is Gregory Marcus. Gregory is a project leader at the Netherlands Institute for Sound and Vision, where he runs the Revive Project and Initiative. And that is a project that brings together the world of cultural heritage and electronic music as a way to change the way we hear the past. That's what I've said. So I'd like to ask Gregory to start with the presentation and do the first one.
Hello. So my name's Greg, and Revive, an initiative by the Netherlands Institute for Sound and Vision that hopes to change the way we hear the past. This is us. We're located in Hilversum. It's about half an hour outside of Amsterdam, and we are the National Audiovisual Archive of the Netherlands. Why do we do Revive? Well, because we hope that stuff like this happens, and I hope there's sound. Okay, so what was that? That was the great Aphex Twin playing the track Maslin Kieran Gating off of techno duo Lacquer's last LP called Struggle and Emerge out on RNS Records. And so, okay, well, Aphex Twin plays lots of tracks. What's so special about this one? Well, this track is off of our very first Revive release. It is made exclusively out of resampled archival field recordings and audio ripped from archival films that pertain directly to the theme of the Dutch and water. So you can imagine 25,000, however many thousands of people are at Bilbao Music Festival with Aphex Twin headlining, going off their faces to a track that's about Dutch flood management and flood protection. So what does Revive do? Why do we do it? Well, it all stemmed from this initiative that there needs to be this creative use of digitized archival material, because we're putting all this money into digitizing archival material, and how can we kind of show its value in different markets, and not just for research potential, and you know, what are the different accesses for reuse or new engaging new audiences with this material. well, after a bunch of projects that had to do with apps and digital culture that were all flopping, I said, well, why aren't we just working with the electronic music community if we're working with audio? Because, well, it's kind of, if you think of remix culture, it just comes from, at least for me, I relate it directly to electronic music. It's one of Europe's, it's one of Europe's largest creative communities, so it's very easy to work with them. It's everywhere. There's a very vibrant culture around it. It's hyperactive. Everyone's looking for something new. They're always on the cutting edge of new sound and kind of music or conceptual or artistic visions. It's extremely innovative. It's extremely well connected. So if you just like tap into one little ecosystem, then all of a sudden you have friends in a network all around the world. And it's a great way to present this archival material that otherwise no one would probably be listening to or looking at or interested in to huge audiences. So how do we do it? It was really important because in the past, you would hear these initiatives about creative reuse of archival material where we want to engage the creative industries. That term engaging a creative industry, if you're from any sort of artistic community or creative community, the idea of being engaged by some institute just kind of doesn't sound very nice. So I came from the punk DIY scene in the Midwest and in the United States. And the best way to be part of a creative community is to be part of that creative community. So we really didn't want to have this outsider perspective. We really wanted to be hyper-engaged and to be part of the community. And so what do we do? Well, we put out new releases that are made out of archival material, or perhaps they're new film scores that were written for archival films. We do workshops, new performances, film scores, we write blogs, blah, 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 blah. And so now I'm just kind of going to run through very quickly some of the stuff we've done to show some context of actually just how much you can do with archival material and not even just audio material. So this is our first one, Lacquer, Struggle, and Emerge, which you just heard Aphex Twin playing the track from. As you can see, this is a flood in the Netherlands, Vieringermeer, 1945. The Germans had blown the dike in Vieringermeer when they were pulling out. And so this is an image from an archive in the Netherlands. And like I said, it's only made out of resampled archival sounds related to this theme that we curated for them. And we brought them over to the Netherlands and they met a bunch of experts so they could get context that would then inform this album. And Struggle and Emerge is an English translation of the motto of Zeeland, the province of Zeeland, where the North Sea flood of 1953 was, and their motto is Lucter et Emergo in Latin, which I don't speak. But moving on, so we did this one album, it's great, it was on RNS. People were like, wow, you did your first record on RNS, what comes next? Well, then we just did two compilations. So this is Domrock, and this is Nultien 010, it's the area code for Rotterdam. And this was a great way to just test this idea that we had on about like 30 different artists. So again, they could only use sounds, archival sounds from these two cities respectively. And well, pressing vinyl takes ages and it costs a lot of money. So we thought, well, how can we have a physical copy? Because you can download these for free under Creative Commons licenses. So our physical copy was photo books where we had the artists who made the tracks curate photos from the National Archive of the Netherlands, who have a wonderful open images collection, like tens of millions of images in high res in the public domain for you to do whatever you want with. And so those were the physical outputs. And again, it allowed us to work with another archive and say, hey, this community is interested in what you have. Can we, let's use your image collection and then you can be involved with this community as well. And people can learn about your great collection. And then we moved on to another thing. I guess it was just like most relatable for what we've been talking about. But this was done with the ethnographic audio archive from the Tropen Museum in Amsterdam that was formed by Jaap Kunst way back in the 1930s or 1920s, I can't remember. But our institute holds this music collection, and you can imagine it's tens of thousands of field recordings that were never published from all over the world, mostly Suriname in Indonesia. So again, we invited these artists in to do these records, to learn about it. They came to the Netherlands and met with ethnomusicologists and researchers and whatnot, and it resulted in three completely different albums, and one that never saw the light of day because the artist didn't feel comfortable releasing what he had made due to ethics and his own position as a white man in New Zealand. So just very briefly, Clap Clap did a record. Maybe some of you are familiar with him. Paris Smith did a record. I want to come back to that one. And then Ash Kusha also did a record. And these are all available for free on different respective labels. And what this taught me was that we wanted to stay away from the ethnographic music collection. We didn't want to get into these topics of sounds that came from the Dutch colonial archive. It was just, it became too complex and it was very uncomfortable. And you really heard all these different perspectives from these different artists. Some of them didn't care at all because they're like, well, this is just music and we really love it. One of them didn't care at all because he said, well, I'm Iranian, so I'm just going to do whatever I want with these sounds. And right down in the middle, we have Paris Smith, who is the son of Surinamese immigrants to the Netherlands. Suriname was a colony of the Netherlands. And he really hit the nail on the head with this one. I really recommend that you go download it. He translates the writings of famous slavery resistance fighter from Suriname, Anton de Kom, who wrote a book called We Slaves of Suriname. And he translated that through these sounds into this beautiful conceptual record that's extremely dark and really is takes head on this topic of Dutch colonialism, which actually up until a few years ago in the Netherlands really was not surfacing in the cultural heritage sector. It's becoming more visible now, but in any case, this record was a little bit ahead of its time and it really deserves more attention, so definitely go check it out. Moving on, I only have 2 more minutes. So these are some live performances that have to do with these outputs. Lacquer doing their Struggle and Emerge AV show. We have Hook at Rewire Festival doing something that he did for us. In the middle, Hati Fati did a revived project in Poland with their National Audiovisual Archive, now called FINA. And I want to move on to this one just because audio archives or audiovisual archives, it's not just about music or, you know, our institute has a very large radio collection, a very large physical collection. So we wanted to get down to the root. I heard a Morse recording of Morse code. I thought like, well, this is just a sine wave with a rhythm. You can do whatever you want with this. And then researching more, you know, telegraphy is really one of the origins of electronic music with this idea of just like a pulsed voltage that's cut on and off and you get a rhythm and you get a sound and you get a message, of course. And so we invited Antennas, Laurie Napoleon, a producer from Brooklyn, to integrate a telegraph key into her live modular rig, which as you can see is already kind of integrating kind of old school telecom switchboard stuff. She was already super into this world. We hooked her up with Bernard, the fellow that you see there with the headphones, who was an old Morse operator. And they debuted telegraph music at Rewire Festival last year, which I was super happy with. We were able to have the audience write down these messages and then they were given to Bernard and he tapped them out. And then that was the only information, the only signal that she was getting to fuel her modular rig. And she was translating these messages and turning them all to weird, like, kind of deconstructed techno. We do film scores because not everyone's into, you know, repurposing a telegraph key or resampling, like, a flood pump somewhere in the Netherlands into some, like, kick drum. But we have a large film collection, and we also have the I Film Museum in the Netherlands. So we're doing a bunch of film scores. Producers writing new film scores for archival films. Not super innovative, but also a lot of fun. And now we've opened up our vinyl collection, which is actually still a functioning music library for the radio broadcasters. And we're inviting diggers in to come go through it. And we do our broadcasts on Red Light Radio in collaboration with Discogs as well. And lastly, this is a great photo. This is one of our workshops we've done. We've done a bunch of them. But this was actually here in Berlin at the Museum for Naturkunde, who, if you don't know, have an incredible animal sound archive. The URL is literally animalsoundarchive.org. And it's all Creative Commons and openly available for you to do whatever you want with. So we did this with them. People got to reuse the collection. It's not a great photo. But that's Knut. Dude's working next to it, probably reworking some like toad sound into some synth sound. And yeah, I'm super happy. We got to put out a lot more music. We went to Lithuania and did a project there, reusing traditional Lithuanian folk music invited by the Traditional Music Archive. And Repping Dekmantel, a great festival and label in the Netherlands. And we're getting more and more of these like big name labels and festivals and organizations interested in this whole idea of reusing archival material, presenting archival material, inviting new producers to work with archival material, and really trying to grow our network and get other institutes and archives involved to open up their collections, make them available, and represent them to new audiences. So that is my time. Thank you.
So, good evening. My approach today is going to be slightly different from what we've been looking at. And basically what I'm looking at is the music archives and accessibility, especially for commercial purposes. The panel that we had ahead of us was very, very interesting. And there are a couple of issues that probably as I go through my presentation, we'll be able to delve into further detail just to see how how to deal with these particular issues. Now, when you talk about archiving, what exactly are we talking about? And I think that's one of the issues that we need to be very clear about, because there's the whole issue of just having simple collections. So, I mean, if you have a collection, would you have the authority to put it out there? When you're talking about archiving in the classical sense, you're probably looking at rare music or something that is probably out of print, and it's something that you're putting it out. And then who are the keepers? Who are these people who keep this archived? So one of the first things that I'll be looking at is the whole issue of creativity builds upon creativity. So you find that in many cases, people want to use whatever is existing for them to be able to come up with something new. And at the same time, we have to remember that culture is dynamic. Because I think many times when you're looking at issues of archiving and everything, it's an issue of preservation, and it's an issue of trying to keep an identity. But I think history has taught us that basically culture is dynamic. So basically, whatever it is that we are listening to in the 70s and what we are listening to right now evolves. So the question is, how do you get that particular music out there for the people who are there to be interested in that particular music? And I'll probably also look into the issue, why are we archiving the music in the first place? So is it for preservation, or are we trying to get it out there for commercial purposes? Or how do we retrieve material from the archives for us to be able to deal with it? And probably my take, because we heard about the whole issue of reissuing. And this is basically, we're talking about music that has been there probably in the very recent past, so probably the last 50 or 60 years or 40 years or even 30, 20 years. But if we take a step back and look into what we are getting from the traditional cultural heritage, and with that I just wanted to give an example, and this is something that I think practically, I mean, quite a number of us would be familiar with this particular video. I don't know whether this will work. So I'm going to take you through a couple of videos and see whether you'll see the progression. This is traditional music from the Ami community. So when you listen to that, that's actually traditional music from the Ami community, and it's basically performed at some presentation and everything purely in the traditional context. Then we move on to the next slide.
Yeah, hi, oh, hi, oh, hi, oh, hi, oh.
So you find this is part people who are part of the community, and they've commercialized. They've basically remastered this particular music. It's part of the traditional music, and then they've come up with a new version. And then we take a couple of steps forward. Now this is Enigma, which is, I think, something which is more recent. Return to Innocence. Sorry. So, I mean, when you look at those three tracks, basically it's you started off with the traditional context of it, and then we are moving on to the point whereby it's being commercialized. Now, that's why I was telling you my presentation is going to be slightly different from what we've had, because I'm looking at it in terms of the archives in relation to the, you know, the traditional cultural expressions that we're having. And the question is whether how we can retrieve that information and be able to use it for commercial purposes. So there's the whole discourse that we've had prior to that of the issue of reuse, you know, basically republication of works that are already within, you know, the realm of copyright. But here we're looking at works that it's music. So initially, when you're looking at all these things and looking at some of the presentations we had yesterday, you find that the main reason of archiving this is for purposes of preservation. But we're looking at it from the commercial angle. Another example that I have is, for instance, in Kenya, we had a group called Kayamba Africa. And what they tried to do is to try and get music from different ethnic communities around the East African region, and then they produce it for commercial purposes. So they give it the modern kind of twist so that people can be able to identify with it. So the whole issue of you saying we're just archiving for purposes of preservation, the question is, and then what? So you find that there's a great interest that is coming up in terms of the use of this particular music, because people are looking for new sounds, you know, in this. And I think in the digital age, it makes it so much easier. We've heard of the different repository systems, the archives that are available online. And these are the kind of things that we'd be looking into. I'm sure we'll have more time to discuss all these issues, but I'm just looking at very simple issues of how do we facilitate this particular access. So you find that in many cases we have a problem of institutional framework. That's a big issue. Who exactly needs to do this particular work? Is it something that should be left to the private entities, or is it something that should be done by government or other public entities, probably like the National Archives, the libraries, and all those other issues, I mean other institutions. Then there are challenges in relation to copyright law. We're just having a quick discussion before this based on the panel that we had ahead of us. If you're doing, for instance, something to in relation to a reissue, where, I mean, does copyright still have a say? If it is something in the public domain, we shouldn't even be having this particular discussion because anybody should be able to access it. But then if it is something that is still within the protection under the copyright law, how do we access it? How do we get these permissions? How do we deal with these particular issues? And then there's also the whole issue of lack of documentation. If you're talking about the traditional cultural expressions, you find that yesterday we had about the singing wells, and we also had I think it was, is it Brian who was talking about, you know, the documentation of African, the culture, music and everything. So how do you access this particular work? And because of the increased demand that we have for this for commercial purposes, and this is coupled by the fact that digitization has made it easy for people to start looking for work, it is important that we actually do come up with very specific repository systems. Sorry, I'm running out of time. I'm not going to deal that, I mean, much about that. Private archiving systems, so they seek to record, archive, and share the traditional music to sustain and celebrate the extraordinary cultural musical heritage, to keep the legacy, and I'd also hasten to add that it is also to make that music available so that the people, especially the younger generation, can have something, you know, not so much to identify with, but something that they can come up with something new. So the archive plays a very important role in that. So finally, there's need to have a clear strategy, especially at the national level, in terms of how do we identify this music. We need to have very systematic documentation with very clear rules and guidelines as to how to be able to deal with these particular issues. We have to be able to have clear systems of conservation. Again, we'll have to be able to demarcate whether something is in the public domain or whatever it is. Accessibility. How do you want to access this particular work, especially online? And then last but not least, and I think my colleague Cornelia is going to deal with this particular issue, is creating the commons. Because as I said at the beginning, creativity builds upon creativity. So I think it's crucial that we are able to come up with a system whereby we identify the works that we want to have in the commons. We know who the people in the commons are. And then we have very specific guidelines and rules as to how we can be able to access the commons. So that way, we are able to preserve the archives, but at the same time, ensure that this work is accessible for those who'd want to use it for commercial purposes. Thank you.
Good evening. Here from South Africa, I bring you greetings from South Africa, where it's still nice and warm because we're just ending out summer. I think that I have a presentation that's going to feed right into this one that you've just heard, because I've been director for 10 years of an archive that has done quite a few of the things that Maricela has suggested. My experience as director of the International Library of African Music, in particular with cataloging, digitizing, and creating online access to ILAM's holdings from 2007 to 2009, led to many opportunities for reuse of ILAM's collections of field recordings, photos, and films, most notably those of its founder, Hugh Tracy. When cataloging and digital conversion of ILAM's holdings was accomplished, I realized, now that we know that we have, it's time to give it back to the communities it came from and back into the public sphere. Various projects over the following years led me to advocate that an ethic of reciprocity be adopted as basic to 21st century cultural research and archival practice. This implies that, whenever possible, digital return of historic recordings to their source communities and consultation with surviving artists, community members, and descendants of the musicians recorded regarding accuracy of existing metadata and conditions for accessibility and reuse of their music heritage be undertaken. Further, given possibilities available in the digital age we live in, there is a need to develop a professional ethic among archivists and researchers of cultural heritage to undertake collaborative projects that promote sustainability of the heritage and bring benefit to the artists and the communities documented. Sustainability of the International Library of African Music itself as a research institute and heritage archive requires generating income for operating expenses. One way this is done is through sales of Hugh Tracy's original Sound of Africa and Music of Africa compilations, and of recent releases through collaborations with production companies. One of the most recent is with an American company called Dust to Digital, released in June last year, Listen All Around is a compilation from the golden age of African music that we were hearing about in the previous panel. This is a beautiful compilation of two CDs, and it brings income to ILM because a contract was negotiated with Dutch Digital that brings us 50% of the return after production expenses. A second very current project is with a production company called Beating Heart, where the two musicians from the UK, a musician and an IT specialist, are doing this project from the UK, and what they're doing is taking ILM's original, Hugh Tracy's original field recordings from various parts of Africa. They started in Malawi, and giving those recordings to established DJ and remix artists from the UK and other parts of the world, and then releasing the original recordings in one compilation and the remixes in a second one. Now, the condition that I put on approving this project was that the original recordings also be released, not only the remixes, because the remixes, of course, you can't recognize very much of anything from the original recordings. They're also staging events at festivals in Africa and Europe. They've made the releases from Malawi and South Africa, and more recently they've been in Tanzania and Kenya and Zanzibar. They were on stage at the Sauti Basura Festival in February in Zanzibar and featuring one of the musicians from Malawi who they collaborated with. So this is a collaborative project that's bringing the archived recordings, the historical recordings, into the public sphere, but I wouldn't really call it a sustainability project. Now, what I want to talk about most is our recent non-income producing collaborations. I was privileged from 2014 to 16 to carry out digital return of Hugh Tracy's recordings to several surviving musicians and many descendants of musicians recorded by Hugh Tracy in Eastern and Southern Africa. The recordings were also given to cultural organizations, local musicians, universities, and national archives. No restrictions were put on future use of the recordings by recipients because the recordings belong to them. They are their cultural heritage. Presently, due to lack of funding for fieldwork of this kind, ILM is actively encouraging PhD and master's degree students to undertake projects in music heritage sustainability that utilize Hugh Tracy's audio-video recordings and instrument collection. I want to share with you now several examples of these projects designed to combine research with digital return and efforts towards sustainability by engaging with youth in creative projects that teach skills and, whenever possible, bring monetary benefit to the artists involved. The first of these was conducted by Robbie Campbell, a SOAS PhD candidate. His is an interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary research project that focuses on music cognition and dyslexia. And he contacted me at ILM saying that he was going to do fieldwork in Mozambique and the nature of his project. And I asked him if he wouldn't please consider carrying Hugh Tracy's films and images and audio recordings of Timbila xylophone music and giving them back to the composers and Timbila players that he worked with. And this he very willingly did and went exactly to the region where the recordings were made to do his fieldwork, which is the Zavala district in Mozambique. Here you see an image of Estavio, one of the composers and Timbila makers that Robbie worked with most, watching an ILM film of Timbila performance that was made in the 1940s and by Hugh Tracy, and then another couple of films that were made by Hugh Tracy's son, Andrew Tracy, were also returned. Everything was given on flash sticks, memory sticks, and MP3 and MP4 format, but Robbie also lifted the audio from the film so that people who didn't have a way to watch the films could still listen to the audio. He located six Timbila composers, but and three people who were capable of building the instrument, but only this man, Estavio, had the materials to build with. And Robbie spent an extensive period of time in the village learning to play timbila himself, and of course came away with the conclusion that this type of music learning is effective in the treatment of dyslexia. He made a very sensory film from the recordings that he made, the film that he shot while working in that village. He had three timbila players with cameras strapped around their head and then one stationary camera, so he had a lot of good footage to work with. Then a second PhD project conducted by Jocelyn Moon of the University of Washington involved digital return of 450 Imbira recordings to the community in Zimbabwe, where they were made by Hugh Tracy and his son, Andrew Tracy. In the process of doing this, she did extensive field work in 2016 and came to Ilam for 2 months in 2017 and searched the archive for any additional recordings of Imbira music that hadn't been cataloged when we originally cataloged and digitized the archive. And believe it or not, she found some from 1969 that were made by Andrew Tracy. And one of the women in the community where she was working was a singer on these recordings. So she was able to give them back to her. And she has paid attention to how the people in the village have reclaimed the recordings after they're given back to her. There's a story about one Metepe player who became a Pentecostal minister. So when she came to the village to give the recordings, he hadn't played his instrument in something like 15 years, and the church forbade it. And this is part of what has happened in villages in Zimbabwe, is that the fundamentalist missionaries from the Pentecostal church have discouraged the playing of the traditional music. Now, there's a lot to this, and there's going to be a lot more about it at 7 o'clock when Stefan Frankel hosts the performance by the Zonke family, who Jocelyn worked with, and talks about his project to create a website that teaches and allows people to learn to play Imbira from the website, and also presents transcriptions. And he has 30 sampled tunings of five types of Imbiras up on his website. But Jocelyn also made very good use of the internet by creating a blog called yellowweaver.com, and I would recommend you to look at it. It's totally interesting reading of her experiences and doing her field work, and also has transcriptions and various information about Metepe Imbira music, and also a Facebook page called Sympathetic Resonances. And finally, at Ilam, our sound engineer decided to do a master's degree and using recordings of Xhosa music from the region where Ilam is located in South Africa, he contacted a number of poets and beat makers in the community and gave him the recordings and said, here, why don't you sample from these instead of the Western music that you're usually sampling from? And they did that. One of the songs he gave them was a bow song, and this poet who calls himself Antala Kanyisa, the one who tells the truth, was inspired by this original recording of bow music sung by a woman named Known Twintwi. I'm just going to give you she's singing about how something bad is going to happen. Okay, so then Ntala took this same song and wrote his own poem and collaborated with a beat maker to create the music and produced his own composition. And I'm going to just play so you can hear his poem. The instrumental backup was done by ...
kwenzeka xa sihamba umdali kaSirayeli simfulathela imithetho yakhe siyityeshela ubumnyama bakusilandela bawusonile xolela siphila kwilizwe linobundlobongela akukho xolo emhlabeni nabo bebulalana besabana bedlombula abantwana alitshoni lingenandaba siphila kwilizwe linamanyala mabohlulo obungcwele kubugqwirha mabohlulo obungcwele
Okay, and then finally, right now this project is going on. A master student named Joe Makanza has gone up to the Limpopo province where the Venda live, and by looking through the instruments in Ilam's instrument collection, he identified five Venda instruments that are potentially endangered, with the exception of the ocarinas. The ocarinas are still being played by school children, but they're being made out of fiberglass and plastic, and Joe would like to see them made out of the original gourd materials that they were historically made from. And you see him here with a Venda instrument maker, who he worked with, and when he showed me these five instruments, I thought, well, it's going to be a miracle if he manages to make one of these big xylophones called the Mbila Mutando. What you see on the left is Ilam's instrument on display, and in the lower right-hand corner is the instrument that he built with the instrument maker up in Venda just now in January of this year. It's not quite finished, and the problem is that no one knows how to play it except Joe. The older instrument maker knows how to make the instrument, but he doesn't know how to play it. And Joe, of course, you know, money for graduate student projects is limited, and we're now looking to find money for him to be able to go back and engage with the youth and teach them to play these instruments and potentially teach a young person how to build them as well, at least one young person. Thank you very much.
So, good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here at this festival dedicated to archive and music. It's not my natural habitat. I'm a fine artist, and I really enjoy all the music and all the discussion around music very much. So, I'm afraid I'm maybe a little bit off topic, but we'll see how what I have to contribute sits with what we have heard so far on this panel. The goal of this project, Find a File, is to look into archiving practices under the digital condition. Basically, when it comes to archives, we can distinguish between various aspects of archives. First, preservation. Second, preselection, which means making curatorial decisions about what is worth going into the archive and what shall be abandoned. And thirdly, we have to look at the accessibility of the archived material. In this context, I'm particularly interested in the special opportunities, but also challenges digital network technology provides for archives. So the title of my talk is Artistic Shadow Libraries: What or How Can Artists Contribute to the Creation of Cultural Memory and the Commons? So within the framework of this festival, which is about archives, I'm going to introduce to you a number of projects which are called Artistic Shadow Libraries. These are archiving projects initiated and run by artists as part of their aesthetic practice. The starting point for all of these projects is a personal interest or a need. And out of that, massive archives have been accumulated that go far beyond personal interests, but rather provide access to cultural memory that oftentimes would have been lost or remained inaccessible without the work and dedication of these artists. Before I'm going to introduce to you a selection of these projects we have been working with, I would like to briefly frame them within the larger context of shadow libraries. A shadow library is more or less the same thing as a library, which means collecting, ordering, and making available published information under aspects of archival, economic, and synoptic aspects. The difference with shadow libraries is that they do not have an official mandate or status. The infrastructure of shadow libraries is being conceived, built, and run by individuals or small groups of people who usually prefer to stay anonymous for obvious reasons. With regards to the media contents provided, most shadow libraries are peer-produced in the sense that they are based on the contribution of a community of supporters. What is specific about shadow libraries, however, is the fact that they make available anything their contributors consider to be relevant, irrespective of its legal status. That is to say, shadow libraries also provide unauthorized access to copyrighted publications, and they make the material available for download without charge and without any other restrictions. Therefore, shadow libraries are often also referred to as pirate libraries. There's a quite interesting history to shadow libraries, which I cannot elaborate on at this point, but if you're interested, there is a major publication that came out last year, and I also discuss this history within a text I've published last year titled The Surplus of Copying. Nevertheless, so, I mean, this is a really huge ecosphere. As I said, I cannot go into that. But very briefly, just so that you get an idea where we are with shadow libraries, Gigapedia and Library.NU have been the first large shadow libraries which had to be closed down for legal reasons. Currently, the leading shadow library is LibGen, Library Genesis, together with Sci-Hub. And just for you to get an idea that it's not some niche or side phenomena, LibGen holds 25 million documents, 2.1 million books of 27,000 different journals and 1,300 publishers. And what they hold in particular is academic scientific publications. The related project Sci-Hub is an online service that processes requests for paywalled articles, providing systematic, automized, but also unauthorized backdoor access to proprietary scholarly journal databases. According to Nature magazine, Sci-Hub hosts around 60 million academic papers and was able to serve 75 million downloads on a daily basis. 70,000 users access approximately 200,000 articles. So that just gives you an idea of the size. So I'm not going to talk about Alexandra Obakian, who runs Science Hub. She's a very famous woman, meanwhile, has to live underground for obvious reasons. What I still want to say about shadow libraries is really that they could be called manifestations of what is called radical open access. Radical open access is a term that has also been coined by Aaron Swartz. In his manifesto, the American hacker and activist pointed to the flaws of open access politics and aimed at recruiting supporters for the idea of radical open access. Radical in this context means to completely ignore copyright and simply make as much information available as possible. Basically, it addresses the what he calls privileged in the sense that they have access to information as academic staff or librarians, and he calls on their support for building a system of freely available information by using their privilege, downloading and making available this information. So this is just to give you a kind of an idea and background where these projects that I'm going to talk about now are situated. My own background is this currently research project called Creating Commons at the Zurich University of the Arts. Together with Felix Stalder and Shusha Niederberger, we are exploring contemporary cultural practices and how they can be read as response to a larger cultural development. And we are doing empirical research. That means we start with specific existing projects, and the projects we are interested in are projects that provide access to resources, often by building technical infrastructures or by organizing settings for informal knowledge transfer. They take care of specific cultural goods and make sure these goods remain widely accessible. We use the idea of the commons as a conceptual framework to instigate a discussion about understanding cultural goods beyond the paradigm of intellectual property and ownership, but rather as a common good that should be taken care of by a community on their own terms of use. And that's probably something we can talk about with Marisela afterwards, because I think we both use this term commons, but maybe, or certainly coming from different backgrounds and with maybe different agenda. We'll see. So now I would like to introduce you to this is a screenshot of our website if you want to have a closer look. I'd like to give you an overview of the projects now. The projects cover a variety of contents, from texts and books to sound, art, music, and film. And if you're interested in more depth, I would like to point you also to the video interviews we have conducted with the artists who are running these projects. They are all screened outside in the foyer. And there you also find this little flyer that you can take away. And this flyer provides more information and points you also to the website where you can also find the video interviews with the artists to give you a really great introduction to the projects. So the first project to start with is Monoscope. It's a wiki and a WordPress blog founded in 2004. It's a repository aggregating, documenting, and mapping works, artists, and initiatives related to the avant-garde, media arts, theory, and activism. It provides both an exhaustive indexical overview of those fields and also digital access to rare historic finds. Initially, it focused on Eastern and Central Europe. That is also where it originated, in Bratislava, in Slovakia. And its spiritus rector and movens is artist Dušan Barok, who has built the wiki and maintains the site. It is easy to get editor rights to the site and to contribute. So if you go to the site and find something missing, you're welcome to add to the archive. The wiki currently contains 6,500 pages and about 12,000 uploaded files. And it has about 4,500 registered users at the moment. In parallel to the wiki, Monoscope also maintains a blog repository featuring daily releases of books, journals, and other printed archival material, some freshly digitized by Monoscope and some contributed by the users, by the authors of these publications, and sometimes also by the publishers. So the next project, which already has been touched upon yesterday, is UBU Web, Cultural Memory of the Avant-Garde. Since the New York-based poet and writer Kenneth Goldsmith started UBU in 1997, the site has become a major point of reference for anyone interested in exploring 20th century avant-garde. The online archive provides free and unrestricted access to a remarkable collection of thousands of artworks, amongst them over 700 films and videos, over 1,000 sound art pieces, hundreds of film dance productions, an overwhelming amount of visual poetry and conceptual writing, critical documents, but also musical scores, patents, electronic music resources, plus an edition of vital new literature, the UBU editions. UBU contextualizes the archive objects within curated sections and also provides framing academic access. And also it is a project run by Goldsmith without a budget, so there is no money involved. It has built a reputation for making all the things available one would not find elsewhere. The content, however, is not presented in a consistent taxonomy model, but is mainly collected and organized along the interest of its operator. Theoretical statements by Goldsmith, in which he questions concepts such as authorship, originality, and creativity, imply a conflictual relationship with the notion of intellectual property. Therefore, it comes as no surprise that the increasing popularity of the project goes hand in hand with a growing discussion about its ethical justification. Third project I would like to introduce is ARC. ARC.fail is the current domain name. It's a content management platform specialized in texts and books in architecture, art philosophy, and media theory. It evolved in the context of an informal educational project, the public school in Los Angeles in 2004. And from project-based sharing of reading material, ARC developed further to become a main source of academic writing in the above fields. The central server, which is shared with other friendly projects, runs a basic content management system and hosts the repository of uploaded items. I do not have exact numbers regarding the size of the project, but the more than 150,000 users have certainly created a very comprehensive resource. That is maybe something specific to ARC. Unlike other projects in these ecosystems, ARC is very much user-driven and peer-based when it comes to its contents. ARC is not the private library of its founder, Sean Dockray, made public, but a resource put together by its users. This is certainly due to its origin in the context of self-organized learning, and is also reflected to a certain degree in its setup that provides various forms for collaboration and discussion on the website. So how are we time-wise? Whoops, almost out. So very, very brief. I don't go into detail, but I at least have to show you Memory of the World. As I've said, there is the interviews outside. If you're interested, I'd just like to mention Memory of the World is a project that uses the notion of a public library to work around issues of accessibility, wide accessibility of knowledge. And the last one is the project OXDB, which is different because it's a film database which uses digital network technology for experimental archiving and making available of films. So I think I stop here and then we can dive into the discussion.
Thank you everybody for your presentations. We have here different approaches, of course, we have assembled very different approaches to working with archives, opening up their contents to the public and bringing it to the public. Greg, your project would be to involve artists to remix it, kind of transform the contents of archives in a bit more popular format and bring it back to the people, to maybe sum it up like that. I just give a short rundown for everybody, the way I understood it. Maybe the work that you do also with the kind of repatriation you do of the music library content would be to bring back the recordings and the pictures to the origins, to the people that they were made with or that made them, and just symbolically hand them over in digital formats to the communities that they came from. So.
Not just symbolically, but give them a chance to engage with it and hopefully promote sustainability.
Sure. Maricela would opt for an open, a common-based access to traditional recordings to make them also available for commercial purposes, not only for preserving them, but also to just kind of revive them to bring them back in the commercial sphere, whatever that might be. We could discuss it in a second. And the what you just presented to us, also the shadow libraries would include a radically open access to the contents. In this case, we should say including music, and that might have the disadvantage of not compensating the musicians. So it would just be there. If you're interested, you can just grab it and do whatever you want with it. So all of you, I mean, these very different approaches of or ideas that you have or perspectives that you have, what would this music or the results need to have to keep the original content? I mean, what so that it does not lose its soul? I mean, if you do a remix project with, Lacquer or Clap Clap remixing the track, I guess there's not much, I mean, there's elements of that, But you know, there's something gets lost as well. It gets transformed. Let's put it that way. Or if you take the original recordings that you Tracy has done and you bring it back on a USB stick to the community, which is a beautiful thing, as you said, as you rightfully pointed out, it's not just symbolically, but it's you know, then the community has it. So what would need to be transported when you do these acts that you've just all proposed? That would be my initial questions, if we could discuss this. Also, if you do that, if you open it for commercial purposes, I imagine, let's say, a luo recording of whatever traditional music that might be from Kenya, you use it as a ringback tone on a mobile phone. You know, does something get lost on the way?
For Revive, it really doesn't matter. Obviously, on the Lacquer record, some stuff haven't been touched as well, just maybe compressed in some reverb. But you would never notice the original source if it's just some ship horn or something. Even though the ship horn they use is actually from a very momentous film. The transformation is great. Like, it doesn't really matter what the original source material is, because we make all that original source material freely available anyway. When any stuff comes out, it's a free sample packs you can download under an open license. In terms of the Clap Clap or the Tropen Museum project, everyone went a completely different way, and we don't really put stipulations on how people should work, even though really the rule is you can only use this material. There should be no additional synthesis or drum machines or anything. Of course, some producers can't handle working that way. So Clap Claps has keyboards and whatnot, and you know, an 808 in it. Paris Smith's has violin and other stuff, 303 that he added into it. And then you have Ash Gusha's, which was, you can't hear any of the original material. It's so distorted and so long gone. For us, because we make, except for the Tropen Museum project, because we make all the source material available anyway, we don't really care how it's transformed. We just want it to be transformed in a meaningful way.
Why?
So long as it's good. Why not? I mean, it's fun. It's popular. It gets people interested.
I think we have to speak in terms of ethical. And I would like to stress the importance of ethics in all this, because as the caretaker of this archive for 10 years, of course, it was a daunting thing. When I was appointed director, I was terrified, because the Hugh Tracy legacy and the legacy of the International Library of African Music is known throughout the world, and the recordings are extremely valuable, and of course they had not yet been digitized, the bulk of them. So that was my first task. But then time keeps moving, and they're now all out of copyright. So it means basically that, and everything is accessible online, but we don't have, it's only compressed clips of every recording that's in the catalog that people can access from the ILM website. But and I, as an ethnomusicologist, and also because Hugh Tracy was a colonialist, I have come to my ethical stance as crucial to decolonizing the archive and decolonizing the discipline, or decolonizing the type of work that people doing cultural research, whether they be anthropologists or ethnomusicologists or whatever, have done, and the whole academic enterprise that you lift whatever you need to get your PhD, and then you have a career and you have a nice, comfortable life. But what about all those marginalized people that you got your data from to write your dissertation? So the long and short of it is that we must do whatever we can to sustain the heritage, while at the same time generating income to keep the archive alive, while at the same time engaging youth. So the whole thing with the Beating Heart Project and doing remixes, and Elijah doing his project with local poets to do remixes, is an attempt to at least expose them to their heritage. Not necessarily that they're going to embrace it so much that they're going to start playing this music exactly the way their ancestors did. So Anyway, that's probably enough said.
So that would be a matter of, as you just said, raising the awareness of communities of about their musical heritage.
Well, I think because it's possible, because now everything's digitized and it's easy to carry around flash sticks, the thing is to give, digital return isn't effective unless you give it back in a way that people can use it. So you have to, the people that you're giving it to have a listening device. So by the time I went to Malawi, we were buying portable radios with rechargeable batteries and giving the recordings on flash sticks rather than CDs, because CDs are basically obsolete, although, of course, artists are still making CD compilations and selling them, and Ilam is still selling that compilation with Dust to Digital, and Beating Heart is selling their compilations. So, but you have to engage with the community and find out what format is going to work. And then I think that considerable intervention should happen. And, unfortunately, we don't have funding to do that kind of project, but there are other people like myself, ethnomusicologists, who do have funding for this kind of work, and so it's happening in quite a few places in Australia and America and Canada.
Gregory, I'm sorry that I ask this question a bit harshly, but your project I'm not sure if you know about Europeana.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm the community manager.
Okay. So I was involved in a bit of a different capacity because I also, apart from being a researcher, I'm also an artist myself. I have also a sort of a remix practice as an artist, and I ran into massive copyright problems with that, and that all put me on a path where I got deeply involved with copyright, intellectual property, and so on. But with Europeana, I was involved a little bit, and I thought it's what I found weird about it is opening these archives, official public archives, and commission remix artists to remix the archive. It's like the most boring thing you can imagine as a remix artist, that someone commissions you, gives you the material, and say, make some funny remix out of it, Because as a remix artist, I want to remix what the content that is kind of relevant to me. In my case, it was the Warhol flowers, They have a significance for me. There's a conceptual reason why I want to remix this and not something which is in your archive. So that's why I'm a bit critical. For me, it's one of these typical top-down approaches, which has not so much probably to do with the needs of a remix community, which needs to make sure they can access whatever they want and are legally protected and not being sued afterwards. So that's my criticism of this.
I mean, that's a fair criticism. Like, I don't know if you got to listen to any of the works that we've... And we don't really fully commission. I really don't like that word commission. It's really just inviting. And, of course, they do get a stipend and they do get money, but in the end, they do own the works, and the works are, are theirs to own and theirs to perform. And Lacquer went on and toured their Struggle and Emerge live AV show to critical acclaim on 5 different continents, and it's only made out of reused archival material. And of course, when we invited them, I do my research and I look at different artists and I think, is this part of their workflow? Is this part of their the way they think about concepts and integrating concepts into their work? So and as I said in the beginning of my presentation, it really should not be perceived as this top-down institutional. It's literally just me with a very small budget, but it's more just asking around, saying, hey, are you interested in this? And sometimes people say, I'm not really connecting with the material, and it's not really for me. And then other times, with the artists come out in the end, and they've found something completely new from themselves. At the end of May, we'll have a 5-LP box set coming out on Mord Records, which is a very famous techno label, and a very highly regarded techno label. And I had lunch yesterday with one of the artists who did one of the tracks, and Rotterdam being a harbor town, they're only using sounds from Rotterdam. And this producer was from Bristol. And then all of a sudden he started working with this, and just all these sounds of the harbor. And he reminded him of his time in Bristol. And, of course he's got this like banging 140 BPM broken beat techno track that maybe you don't know it's made out of Rotterdam stuff, but it's not like some goofy remix artistic thing. Like, it's actually a potent techno track that would fit right in at Berghain amongst all the other tracks. It's really part of the community and not some, like you said, goofy remix thing.
I just don't think there is a lack of material to remix. You know, that's my point. I think there's a lot there. And it's just the problem that you always have to take a huge risk as an artist if you remix things that are relevant to you, that you run into copyright problems. I think that's, for me, the problem and not the lack of material.
You made this quote that you also wanted to kind of streamline and economize the tedious and expensive process of sourcing, accessing and clearing the material for this. So it's kind of promoting the artist, making their job easier a bit, like giving them raw material to work with. But I was asking myself the same question. I mean, are these people looking for sample sources, actually?
And it's much more fun when it's illegal.
I can tell you what's not fun, and that's searching a library database that hasn't been configured for like end user purposes. And that's why actually we, for most of the time, we curate the stuff, because I honestly am embarrassed to send an artist to our institute's database and have them start searching on keywords and all the filtering. And that's a rampant problem in the archive and library world, is how we manage and present our databases for end users that aren't researchers or aren't experienced in working with these kind of databases. So, I mean, that is part of where the curatorial part comes from. But then, of course, as you saw, we'll invite DJs into the Vinyl Depot. And I say, you know, if you want, you can search the database. And no, we want to sift through 350,000 vinyl records. And they go insane, like with no sunlight at -5 for 12 hours. And then when we did the Tropen Museum project for the ethnographic sounds, we sent them every single sound we had and let them sift through it. So it's not always a one-size-fits-all approach either. But yes, it is streamlined, and are people looking for samples? I don't know. Our sample packs get like thousands of downloads, so I guess people are interested in the stuff we're putting out, which is super exciting to see that maybe they're using them, maybe they're not, but now someone has this library of 70 archival field recordings of Amsterdam, and maybe they tap into them, maybe they don't, but at least they're there for them to explore if they want to, and they don't have to dive into Europeana, because I will be even though I work with Europeana for 5 years, I'll be the first to criticize that portal is not user-friendly in any way.
Marcella, I mean, talking about raising the awareness for the heritage, when you make these traditional recordings, we should also discuss the term traditional in a second, but I mean, first, when you make these traditional recordings available for commercial purposes, as I imagine ringback tones or for TV advertisements or something, would people learn something about the musical traditions of their people, of their community?
Actually, it's very interesting, because what's happening right now, especially with the younger artists, is that they actually go out actively to find where this particular music is. Because if you look at the history of probably Afrofusion, you find that quite a bit of it is influenced from the traditional cultural expression. So I'm not necessarily traditional, but the traditional cultural expression. So you find it's something that, if you're taking the example of the Mbira, you find that people are trying to incorporate that into their current music to get a different sound. So like I think 2 days ago, we had one of the Kenyan artists performing at the YAM, and you find that most of his music has a very strong, it's influenced a lot by the cultural heritage from Kenya. So the instruments, the beats and everything. So you find that it's not so much making them aware of their tradition, because I think that is something that probably the bus left a long time ago. You know, in the 40s, 50s, people were basically told discard all this and everything. So you have to go into the archives and then make something meaningful out of it. Because if you leave it in the traditional form, more often than not, you will not find much of an audience for it. So for us, the whole issue of opening up the archives is to be able to help create music that people can identify with. So yes, it's part of their identity in terms of culture. And you remember when I started off my presentation, I said culture is dynamic. So the kind of music that probably my great-great-grandparents listened to might be quite different from what my great-grandparents would have listened to, because there are all these other influences that come in, you know, the migratory patterns and all these things in terms of culture. But the bottom line is to have something that you can actually identify with and create something that especially people now can listen to. I didn't have time to play the clip for Kayamba Africa. There's all this music from different communities, which when performed before, it would probably be during the national, what are they called, celebrations or something like that, and nobody would have a recording of them. Then this particular group comes in and they take the music, give a modern twist to it, and suddenly the albums are flying off the shelf and their downloads and everything. So the thing is that archives sometimes, as Greer has just said, it might be difficult for you to get access to them. So how do you make it easier for them to be able to get this particular archived material, so to speak, so that they can be able to commercially utilize it? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I see. And you're also opting for to do that on the basis of a common-based law. Can you explain that a bit? And also maybe you said that there might be some differences between the two of you in the understanding of what is commons in this case.
So basically, when you're talking about the traditional knowledge commons, we're looking for a system whereby you have a very specific resource, in this particular case, the music, that is part and parcel of a particular cultural identity, and there are very specific rules and guidelines in terms of how you can use it. So basically what happens is that you're able to collect all this material, put it in a format where it can be accessed. And in terms of traditional cultural expressions, you know, there are different levels of access, so to speak. So you find that there's that particular music that would be completely sacred and secret. So that one, whatever it is that you want to do, you will not be able to access it because it's specifically used for specific religious purposes. Then you have the traditional music that would probably be sacred but publicly available. So every member of the community knows about it, you can use it and whatever it is. And then you have the music that would be public knowledge. So you know this is the music that we do for weddings, this is what we do for harvest or whatever it is. So that is publicly available. So when you're having a what you call it, a traditional knowledge commons, you're creating a space whereby this material can be put together. And then you have to remember that for quite a number of the African communities, say for a couple of them, you know, you can name a few who had written tradition, but most of them had the oral tradition, most so in Eastern Africa. So, but maybe from the Ethiopians, or you can count a couple of them who have written tradition. So there's need for you to preserve, because as we were given the example yesterday of the Singing Wells, this particular community where there's an 82-year-old, there's the danger of that person disappearing with the commons. So when you create a space where they know that they can actually put out that particular music and it can be used by other parties, so other than preservation, you are creating a space where people can be able to, you know, retrieve it and use it within certain laws and guidelines.
So are you talking about an online space?
Sorry, the commons can be anywhere. It doesn't have, it's not, it's...
It well, are you talking about physical recordings, like somebody goes out and now there's, everything's digital these days.
Yes, it is.
So
it
what
is.
Kind of space do you mean?
It could be digital. Basically, what you're saying is that a place where you can actually create the archive, and people can retrieve that work, but based on specific norms. So you don't just go and download and do whatever it is that you want to do. Probably you'll be told you have to do this within these particular parameters.
So are you envisioning this for Kenya or for the world? Or
That is basically, I think it's world over, because we are talking of a digital space.
Yeah.
So it's not something that I'm just talking about Kenya. Basically, I'm using Kenya as an example.
Right.
But if you're looking at traditional knowledge commons, it's something which is has gained currency in countries like South Africa.
So this is a type of thing where this huge collection of which there are many recordings from Kenya in Hugh Tracy's collection, and they're out of copyright. They could go into your commons, right? And it would be, all you have to do is talk to the people at ILM to get copies. And they're in digital format already. But what I mean is, like, where's the funding going to come from to create this commons? Is it just a legal concept, or is it something concrete that there's a vision to how to implement it?
No, it's actually something that has already been implemented in quite a number of communities. Like, I'll give you the example of the Kakula community in Southern Africa. So you have non-governmental organizations, not-for-profit organizations who work within this particular space. And then, like in Kenya, under the traditional knowledge law, this is something that ought to be done at the different levels of government. You know, we have two levels of government in Kenya. So we have the national level and we have the county level. So at the county level, they should be able, the law actually requires them to create a repository. And the governments at both levels actually do have a fund that has been put aside for those specific purposes. So in terms of creating the commons in a country like Kenya, it would be something whereby the funding would be available, but from the state. Yeah.
Which your colleague just reported yesterday or the day before?
The funding, what my colleague said yesterday is that the funding is there, but it has never been utilized. Yeah, it's not been implemented. Yeah. So you have the law, you have the institutions, you have the funding. But as she said, the money has a habit of hemorrhaging and going to other places. So now those are things which we have to figure out and see. I mean, those are now governance issues that now go beyond whatever is there. But the prerequisites for setting up these particular systems are actually there. So it's just governance issues that make it now difficult for us to implement them.
Yes, we had a conversation before already where I learned a bit more about this, your understanding of the commons. And what I was really surprised about was that it's actually like a codified concept, like a legally codified concept, which is beyond intellectual property in the sense that it's not about ownership of the cultural goods, but it's also not about authorship, which are the two basic concepts of copyright, but it's rather about a community that holds a custodianship about cultural heritage, which is not possible. Within intellectual property law, that would not be possible because you need an author and you need, it's about ownership and licenses and all that. So I found that really interesting. I have not heard about that before, and I think that's also a point where we get closer to each other, also it might be very far away, but I think what brings these approaches together, your approach and maybe the approach of the pirate libraries, is really that it's about containing the copyright industry, but not about abusing things and commercially exploiting things and make cultural goods something for privileged people, but keeping things accessible and available. And that's also, I'm not happy with how you framed me as, you know, my approach is not paying the artists. I think it's much more. Yes, you said it.
We have to come back to that.
Yes, please.
I just, another question about it. Now, you know, I think there's a growing movement for community archives to be established by people like ethnomusicologists and anthropologists who make recordings in communities and then leave them with the community. And it's very complicated in marginalized communities and rural areas where infrastructure is very limited, you know, but if you're lucky enough, and sometimes the schools are the most obvious place to leave this stuff with teachers. And of course, with the interest of sustainability of the heritage as well, that's part of, you know, having a community archive where teachers can access everything and use it in their music programming with their students, right? So the students learn some of their indigenous heritage, right? Not only this don't get totally stuck on this idea that everything has to be new, and although culture is always changing, you know, maybe it's a fantasy to think that we can or should even try to sustain the original, but I think there is definitely value in the original, and like you say, that your identity is bound up in it, so it has to encompass both.
Should we talk about the compensation? I totally understand the concept of the shadow libraries in that it's struggling against this all occupying, you know, capitalization of everything, including, including the arts. So I mean, this is you said that these artistic archiving and library practices challenge the notion of culture as private property. But I mean, one has to say that the downside to that is that then the artist, the creator, would not be compensated.
It is like this killer argument. You know, first of all, copyright industry's interest is not to compensate the artist, but to make huge profits. So if you know a little bit about music industry, you know it's never the artist. In very rare cases, it's the artist who makes the huge profits. There is a huge industry. So I think this all towards this background. And it's really not, I mean, first of all, these projects are run by artists. You know, they are not commercial businesses. They do... Their labor is unpaid, and it's really, I mean, it has different aspects, as I said in the beginning. It's about preservation, for example, with Ubu. Ubu does a big job in preserving things and making things available, and they can only do it because they ignore copyright. And all the big museums, like MoMA and so on, they are totally envious of Ubu because they would love to have a collection like this or an archive. They can't do it because they need to do it under terms of copyright. And they can't. So that means that this pirate library has gained a really a value in as a, you know, as preserving cultural heritage, which other people who want to do it legally, they simply cannot do it for various reasons. And that's why Goldsmith also says it's a zero budget project. And if he would start to clear copyrights, it, you know, for the many thousands of items he has in the archive, he would need to hire 10 lawyers and do contracts, and it would be a completely different thing, and for many works they couldn't be there. So he also tries to be fair, of course, in terms of artists. It's a very clear opt-out system. If someone finds their work on Ubu and says, I don't want it to be there, he takes it down. But the dynamics, interestingly, is the other way around. It's such a prestigious archive, meanwhile, that artists want to be in the archive. You know, they send their work, and he says, that's not what I'm interested in. So it's the other way around. It's almost like a gatekeeper function and not one of exploitation. And I think that we really need to have this non-commercial aspect in the center, you know. And it's, and also, I'm not promoting this this project as a solution to any of the problems we have around IP and commons and accessibility. They are not solutions. They ask a lot. They mainly ask questions, you know. They provide a functionality, an actual function. They do something. But for me, maybe even the greater value, or the two are related, is the discursive value of this project, because they ask questions. They say, what do we do with our culture? Is everything needs to be commercialized? All culture needs to be a private property, and only the ones who can pay for it have access to it. I mean, that's the wider context, and that's the value of this project.
I completely agree in terms of institutes locking down their material, and you know, there should be more of an open access policy, and it should be an institutional policy as well, thinking about how can we open the collection and not just stuff that we have, but new acquisitions. And I feel very privileged to be working at Sound and Vision, where this actually is part of our acquisition policy, where we have a discussion with whomever the makers were, saying, can we make this available under, what kind of licenses can we make this available under? So one of our new undertakings is digitizing and presenting the Dutch video games from the 80s and 90s. And this is something that my colleague Jesse DeVos has worked out, where we can now use these under a Creative Commons Association share alike, or under a Creative Commons Association license, which basically allows for loads of creative reuse. And I just wish that more institutes would have this kind of approach and this kind of dialogue with any makers that they wind up working with, of making sure from the beginning we can begin to open up our collection. Of course, we have a huge backlog that while we have colleagues that make calls and try to open up material as much as possible, and we do have, you know, several hundred thousand films that if you work with the Institute just even loosely, you can use them for free for any creative purposes you want. You kind of have to back channel a little bit, but we are really open to these things. So some institutes definitely get a bad rap, and they definitely deserve it for locking down their content, but there are quite a few very large, prolific institutes that really are trying to be more open.
I'm totally not against this, but I also like to think a little bit ahead and develop a vision, and for that, I think Commons is really interesting, because even if you license something under Creative Commons is based on copyright. So first you need an author and a work, and you have a copyright, and then you can decide as the owner of this item that you want to put a license on.
And I also believe that Creative Commons is inherently flawed a lot for some of the obligations that the licenses offer for things.
It's fantastic for platform capitalism, you know. It has exactly been invented for that. I think we need to think ahead, you know, and commons, and especially, that's why I'm so interested in what you told about the codification of the commons, you know, as a legal concept beyond ownership of cultural goods and authorship, and I think that's a vision. And of course, at the same time, we are here right now, we need to deal with things also in a pragmatic way, but we also need a vision of where we want to go and what we want culture to be and under what conditions we want culture to be produced. And I think the model we have now of the cultural industry, music industry, film industry, is not the one that puts the well-being of the creator in the center. Mm-hmm. Not at all. This is a killer argument. I don't fall into this trap. It's not.
I just
true.
Wanted to provoke you. But I mean, we're almost finished. Our time is almost over. There's just one point that I wanted to mention. Diane mentioned that already, that today everything is digital. So all these archives that we're talking about here are digital archives. And we must not forget, I mean, especially you two working in African countries and African contexts, that not everybody, that for us, I mean, like coming from the global north, we always think, well, when it's digital, it's available to everybody. It's not available to everybody when it's digitized. You know, sometimes you have to go at length to go online and everything. So one must not forget that.
But I think that's a gap that's quickly disappearing. For the simple reason, like if you look at quite a number of the African countries, for instance, in my own country, if you want to get anything to specific places, it's basically delivered digitally. That's, you know, like now the government has come up with the digital villages probably about 10 years ago. And then now you have a very fast internet accessibility.
I know,
And that just with the use of your telephone. So you find that most of these things are actually being delivered. So they do not have the computers. They do not have the routers and all these interesting things that we put around. But they have the mobile phone. Mm. The data bundles are relatively cheap. So anybody who has a smartphone, and even then we have the pseudo smartphones which you can access the internet with, you know, the ones with the QWERTY boards and stuff like that, but still you can access the internet. So the digital divide is actually shrinking. So in terms of, even when we're thinking of archiving, it's normally digital. Like when we're dealing with the Maasai project, it was basically a digital project. I'll give you an example. The Kenya National Library Service, they have like 66 different outlets in Kenya, and they're all digitized, regardless of where. So anybody who has access to the National Library Services will get access to the... So I think that is something that anytime we think about archiving right now, it's automatically a digital archive, because if you're going to put things on paper and stuff like that, nobody's going to bother with you.
No, I'm completely aware of that. I mean, I know that in many areas in Kenya where I've been, there was faster internet, mobile internet, than it is in Germany. So it's I know that. Sure. Before we open up for the Q&A.
Exactly. Yeah. But about the relevance of the shadow libraries, I think I experienced when traveling. I mean, for me, it's a conceptual problem, and a matter of fact, I have access, you know, through university libraries and everything like that. It's not so important, but when I traveled outside Europe in many countries, people approached me and said, you know, you should know that without ARC, one of the archives, it would not have been possible to finish my studies or to write my master's or whatever, because they did not have access through any official institutions or anything. So it was these small kind of small artist projects that provide an infrastructure which provides accessibility to knowledge for people theoretically all over the world. And I think it's amazing what the internet can do. It's a cost of $500-$700 a year that on which this infrastructure is run. It's extremely powerful.
Oh, and that's a very beautiful positive note that we could end on, which I was looking for yesterday when we had this this panel where everybody was just very depressive about the negative influence of Spotify and YouTube on the music production, because they said it's just too much. And well, I know it's the same thing in the musical world, that there's, especially, I mean, in African cities that I've been to, there's so interesting club and electronic music scenes springing up everywhere, because these people there, they are connected over the internet to the whole world, and they just get all the influences from everywhere, and they just do their own thing with it. And often it still sounds distinctly African still, what comes out of it, like not African, but you know, I have to be very special about their culture. Let's say it sounds Yoruban, or it sounds, you know, whatever, Angolan. But, you know, so that it sparks creativity, so I really like that. Yes, so that's that. We should stop it here and ask the audience and open up the panel for Q&A if there are any questions from the audience about the things that we've just discussed. Is that using shadow libraries, or is that questions?
No. Not about shadow library. Just a question. There may be quite a difference in those archived materials if they're kind of like, if there's Sounds of Rotterdam, for example, you said, Greg. Or if it's something from a tribe in Africa or from a particular community in Africa that dates back to 1920 or so. I think that's a kind of like a very wide difference, and should also be in terms of what goes into archives and can be used, is like the industry sounds or something like that that somebody may have recorded. I don't think they want to have a copyright on it. So that is just an observation. I don't know what the question is.
Our institute is in a nice position where we're actually the rights holder for a lot of the material, and then by default we just open it up. And you know, it is kind of nascent sounds like this that really, okay, to a Rotterdammer maybe this has a lot of important meaning, but to anyone else it's just another sound. But you know, we hope, you know, maybe through some artistic transformation or letting a producer kind of sit with it for a while, some of them like actually retrieve a lot of meaning out of it and can really transform it, which I'm always very surprised but also very happy about. So, but yeah, of course, the record collections we have in our music collection and all the ethnographic sounds that we have are not publicly available, and you can't access those. So you're. it's a political discussion between the two different institutes. Yep.
So it's political.
Political, and which then means it's money related. I definitely have a 1 terabyte hard disk on my desk that has all of it, though.
Yeah, sure.
Any other questions here in the room? Is there one? Okay, so then I don't see any. So thanks everybody for joining us. Thanks all the panelists for being up here on stage and all your valuable contributions and presentations. It was very interesting. Thank you.